Welcome to the Whistling Podcast. My name is Kirk Horkin. This is part two of the reading of When People Whistle, a paper written by Peter F. Ostwald in 1959. In the first part, I was just interested in presenting his account of the history of whistling. The brief historical introduction is like a menu of future podcast topics, and I am grateful for it. It was a bit unsatisfying, but in the second part, we get into his real specialty, psychiatry. This podcast will be primarily about the psychology of the whistler himself or herself. It is interesting, and we might learn a few things. After this, I plan on focusing on more fun topics and have a less pretentious show. So the second part of this paper, where we begin today, is also a brief section and covers a lot of things: physiology, pathology, technique, etc. I think that we will find that the techniques to produce a whistle he mentions are pretty narrow and do not begin to cover the vast array of ways that people can whistle. As I mentioned before, there are even nose whistlers. I have seen some pretty amazing videos of whistlers who, almost like ventriloquists, don't even seem to use their lips or mouths at all. As far as pathology, that may be a topic for a future podcast, but it's out of my area of expertise to say the least. I suppose that as a psychiatrist, you do have a considerable amount of medical training, so I will trust the good doctor's authority on that subject. It's not really a very positive thing to look into. I believe that whistling should be a happy, carefree topic. Whistling is something you do to take the edge off the drudgery of a monotonous job, what you do when you see the decline of the natural environment and want to avoid thinking about it, or see the state of American democracy or the horrors of our planet on the evening news. Something you do when skipping or twiddling your thumbs. So let us begin. Part 2: How Humans Whistle. It is possible to whistle without using an instrument. One simply exhales through the mouth and controls the amount of air with the speech organs. The vocal cords are abducted as in breathing. The tongue stays on the floor of the mouth, and air is expelled more or less forcefully through a small opening provided by puckered lips or spaces between the teeth. Some whistlers make a narrow opening by placing two fingers in the mouth. The pitch of a whistle can be varied by altering the shape of the mouth cavity, usually with the tongue. The whistler uses more energy than in speech because he needs considerable muscular control and coordination. Those who cannot close the lips firmly or shut off air flow through the nose may have great difficulty. Children can rarely whistle adequately before the age of 5 or 6. Uncontrolled human whistling usually occurs only when there is accidental leakage of air from the respiratory tract. Persons with articulation defects or badly fitting dentures may whistle while they speak. Artificial openings of the windpipe, tracheotomies, occasionally whistle, as do lung adhesions or cavities due to tuberculosis. Well, I don't have much to say about that. Maybe in the future we may come back to pathological whistling. It is near Christmas when I am recording this, and there is the issue of All I Want for Christmas is My Two Front Teeth, a good example of unintentional whistling.
It seems so long since I could say Sister Susie sitting on a thistle. Every time I try to speak, all I do is whistle. All I want for Christmas is my two front teeth. My two front teeth. See my two front teeth.
So let's move on to the next section called The Whistler, where he gets into the psychology of whistling. The Whistler. What the whistler experiences as he whistles is difficult to define, since it involves a medley of subjective sensations and personalized values. Yet whistling, as a discrete and nicely defined bit of behavior, has its concomitant emotions, which I shall try to spell out. To begin with, when a person whistles, he experiences tension in the muscles of the mouth and face that is accompanied by buzzing and tingling feelings in the skin of the lips and the mucous membranes of the buccal cavity. Such tensions and sensations are similar to those experienced during any process that involves oral gratification, viz., biting, tasting, chewing, salivating, kissing, talking, smoking, etc. And since oral gratification, at least in those people who are mothered during infancy, involved the simultaneous satisfaction of other needs besides hunger, closeness, warmth, protection, etc., whistling may call forth a more general hedonic state than usual in the whistler, reference Greenacre, 1952. In addition to the mouth and face, whistling involves the respiratory structures. These structures, chest, abdomen, lungs, windpipes, and throat, move of their own accord, regulated by neuronal and chemical processes beyond voluntary control. But the whistler, in effect, willfully imposes his own rhythm, amplitude, and organization pattern on these automatic movements. Psychological studies show if the individual is rewarded by attention or praise when he first gains control over such automatic processes, he may continue to expect satisfaction from this display of skill, reference Greenacre, 1952. As will be shown later, whistling arouses the attention of listeners, so that the whistler's bodily mastery is almost universally rewarded in some way. Studies of children suggest that products of the body, like matter from digestion, warm air from breathing, or sounds from the vocal tract, may become invested with great interest, pride, and pleasure once the individual masters the movements that result in such products. Also Greenacre, 1952. Occasionally, children will play with their products and create fantasies in which these inanimate things begin to have a life and existence of their own. Whistling results in a sound, and this, like other products of his willful effort, may be cherished and idealized by the whistler. On the other hand, whistles, like other body products, may come to be regarded as dirty and undesirable. For instance, a child may be taught to believe that his air, quote, smells bad, unquote, or is, quote, too noisy, unquote, with the result that he experiences guilt while whistling or stops this pleasurable activity altogether. Some of the emotions that accompany the act of whistling would appear to result from wishful thoughts and magical fantasies in the mind of the whistler. Whistling, because it involves the production of wordless sounds, may bring back memories of that very early period during which the child could not distinguish between those sounds which came from the outside world and those sounds which came from his own body. During this phase of personality development, one is unsure of the significance of sounds. One cannot tell whether a certain noise, say one's footsteps, has personal meaning referable only to his own body or has a public meaning with some reference to the world of other people. In this confused state, the individual may come to believe that the sounds he produces have some causal relationship to what he experiences. Whistling, like other noises he makes, may thus be associated with fantasies of omnipotence which, unless corrected by reality, can lead to delusions of grandeur. Occasionally, parents or other adults inadvertently encourage magical behavior in their children and thus reinforce fanciful thoughts about whistling and other sounds. For example, nurses have been known to employ whistles to make the child urinate, and kindly grandparents not infrequently whistle away the aches and bruises of a youngster. Certain magical ideas associated with whistling are reinforced by beliefs and superstitions prevalent in the culture at large. Reference De Sirens, 1926. For example, there is an old myth among mariners to the effect that to whistle for the wind will bring a fresh and vigorous breeze to fill the sails. Tales about whistles are numerous in the folklore of various cultures. Suffice it to say that magic whistles which attract birds are described in Celtic tales, and flutes which have power over serpents, demons, and beasts appear in the legends of almost all cultures. Pan, the god of shepherds and flocks, invented the syrinx, a pipe that produced whistling sounds. With it, he startled wanderers in the dark forest. He also used his whistle to enchant King Midas, and one day challenged Apollo, the god of the lyre, to a musical contest.
Pan, the god of wood and fields, of flocks and shepherds, dwelt in grottos, wandered on the mountains and in valleys, and amused himself with the chase, or in leading the dances of the nymphs. He was fond of music, and as we have seen, the inventor of the syrinx, or shepherd's pipe, which he himself played in a masterly manner. Pan, like other gods who dwelt in forests, was dreaded by those whose occupations caused them to pass through woods by night, for the gloom and loneliness of such scenes disposed the mind to superstitious fears. Hence, sudden fright without any visible cause was ascribed to Pan, and called panic terror. As the name of the god signifies all, Pan came to be considered a symbol of the universe and personification of nature, and later still to be regarded as a representative of all the gods and of heathenism itself. Milton, in his glowing description of early creation, thus alludes to Pan as the personification of nature. Universal Pan, knit with the graces and the hours in dance, led on the eternal spring. And describing Eve's abode, in shadier bower, more sacred or sequestered, though but feigned, Pan or Sylvanus never slept, nor nymph nor faunus haunted. Paradise Lost, Book 4.
Another way to explain what the whistler experiences is to look upon whistling as a form of nonverbal signaling. Reference Roosh and Keyes, 1956. Wordless signals usually have a vague and imprecise meaning. They do not usually communicate ideas, but serve rather to attract attention. One requirement of this kind of signal is that it must be easy to perceive by others. Whistles are sounds much easier to hear than words. They tend to be pure tones which concentrate sound energy into a narrow segment of the frequency spectrum instead of spreading it, as in speech, over a wide area. Furthermore, they occur most often in the frequency range of 1,000 to 4,000 cycles per second, to which the human ear is most sensitive. Thus, the whistler can be sure to be heard by random listeners, even at a considerable distance. Alone in the woods or on a prairie, for example, he can signal to birds and other animals. Most people seek companionship and may be rewarded with a pleasant company of a pet or a child if they whistle. In addition to making contact with another being by whistling, the whistler can expect whistling to evoke a sympathetic reaction. Nonverbal signals like yawns, laughs, the cries, lead to immediate emotional rapport, whereas words, which have to be translated and interpreted by the receiver, result in delayed or symbolic behavior. Last but not least, whistlers, since they produce melodies, rhythms, and other sound patterns identifiable as music, experience pleasures akin to those of the performing musician, reference Kohut, 1957. When he, quote, plays on his musical instrument, unquote, the whistler conforms to some of the traditions, rules, and formulas which, over the course of time, have come to be associated with beauty. He also identifies himself with publicly adored figures such as famous composers and artists. There was a lot in that section. I have a bachelor's degree in psychology, and I recognize a lot of Freudian themes there from the oral and anal stages of development. I think I detected a little bit of Abraham Maslow in there as well. It seems appropriate to the time that this paper was written. Having a bachelor's degree means that I don't really know shit about anything except in a very general way, and I haven't studied psychology any further than what I learned 20-odd years ago. Seems that nowadays psychology is more interested in brain chemistry, and it would be interesting to see what happens in the brain when someone whistles. I have found a couple of articles about MRI scans done while people whistle. Maybe I will share what those indicate at a later time. If anyone in the audience is a neurologist specializing in whistling, I would love to talk to you. For now, I'm going to let the article speak for itself. So let's move on to the section about the listener. The listener. Some of the effects of whistles upon a listener have been mentioned in connection with the whistler, who, whenever he is alone, is simultaneously the listener. Listening to one's own whistle may have yet another function, that of echolocation. Griffin and others have found that many animals determine their position and direction in space by listening to the reflection of their own noises. Reference Griffin, 1958. Bats, for example, can fly in total darkness thanks to their ability to navigate by reflected sound. Some blind persons judge distances in the same way, by a form of echolocation known as facial vision. Whistles, as clear, penetrating sounds, may serve such a purpose, and a person who whistles in the dark is not necessarily afraid, but merely exercising his unconscious sense of echolocation. As to the listener who is not also the whistler, his behavior in response to the sound of whistling is a complex pattern. Part of his behavior is due to the fact that sounds can produce an arousal reaction, that the human organism has a deep-seated native capacity to be aroused by sounds is known from observing the startle patterns of intrauterine infants and newborns. Reference Greenacre, 1952. This capacity appears to be enhanced whenever the listener expects to hear a sound, as when an alarm clock wakes him from sleep, or an air raid siren alerts him in time of danger. When a person is engaged in repetitive or monotonous work, sounds tend to alleviate fatigue and to increase his efficiency. This is one reason why music is used for improving the morale and work output in factories and for reducing depressions in mental hospital patients. Whistles not only arouse the listener, they may bother or annoy him. A high-pitched whistle of sufficient sound energy will cause discomfort and pain in the listener's ears. After continuous exposure, the listener may become temporarily deafened to the tones of the whistle, and even permanent damage to the structure of the ears has been reported. It is reported that certain annoying sounds can precipitate convulsions in susceptible individuals. Reference Bevan, 1955. As the result of its arousing and annoying potential, whistling has come to be used for the purpose of controlling people, particularly people in groups. Reference Reusch and Keyes, 1956. Thus, a whistle blast may initiate a marine assault during combat. Whistles signal the start of runners, boxers, or other athletes towards their goal. In the case of human groups that are unorganized and unprepared, whistling, together with other signals, calls attention to a group leader. Such is the case of the students who file into the classroom in an orderly fashion when the whistle blows, or the police whistle which breaks up a riot. The story of the Pied Piper of Hamelin tells about an exodus from the village of children led by the sound of a whistle. Whistles can also be used to halt movements. This fact is known to hunters who kill rabbits by causing them to stop in their tracks at the sound of a whistle. The traffic cop and the referee also call a halt by whistling. Whistles convey specific meanings to the listener only when they are associated with significant ideas or images. This may happen in the case of whistles that have a specific acoustic character, such as those of whizzing bullets or speeding trains. Some people learn to identify each other on the basis of distinctive whistles, and in some families, members have whistles which they use to call to each other over the hullabaloo of a crowd or at a distance. Occasionally, whistles have a stereotyped meaning for a large segment of the community. The wolf whistle, for instance, has come to signify sexiness. Similar patterns of sound are also used to indicate amazement, surprise, astonishment, and other emotions. Rhythmical whistles that resemble the sounds of walking, the heartbeat, machinery, or other familiar phenomena are relatively easy to associate with specific thoughts or images. But much of the time, whistles lack a definite rhythmic form, and like many radio sound effects, have a general sound that suggests vague ideas and moods. Reference Turnbull, 1951. For instance, whistling that rises in pitch suggests something approaching and leads to a feeling of alarm and suspense. Whistles that fall in pitch suggest something receding and create the impression of weakness, cowardice, or failure. If a whistle first alerts the listener and then causes him to have vague thoughts and ambiguous feelings, we say that the whistle has put him into a state of suspiciousness, He begins to wonder what is really going on and tries to find out. He strains his ears and eyes and searches restlessly for the origin and significance of the sound, much like a hard-of-hearing person who receives only a fragment of the information contained in speech. He remains dissatisfied until he locates and understands the noise. Suspiciousness can lead to panic. It also seems to be a useful self-protective form or behavior in the face of danger. For example, during World War I, the British Army trained a unit of specialized sound rangers whose responsibility it was to listen for the whistles and explosions of enemy artillery bombardments. Reference Innes, 1935. In the face of enemy submarines, sea captains learn to listen suspiciously for telltale underwater sounds. For the purpose of testing machinery and motors, listeners and listening devices are employed in order to discover any whistles, rattles, and other vague noises. Sounds are also among the most important clues for the evaluation of health and disease in clinical medicine. Reference Dothwaite, 1954. Pathological whistling, although it does not occur as frequently as abnormal lung or heart sounds, occasionally indicates serious physical malfunction. For example, in veterinary medicine, the whistling horse requires immediate attention. The whistle is symptomatic of obstruction of the respiratory tract because of laryngeal paralysis. Pathological human whistles include those resulting from asthma, diphtheria, and other conditions that interfere with breathing. An inability to whistle may also be of pathological significance and has been reported as one of the diagnostic signs of myopathy or paralysis. Psychiatrists occasionally observe exaggerated responses to whistles in patients with emotional disturbances. These hypersensitivities are diagnostic clues that can point up severe underlying psychopathology. For example, a woman seen in our clinic gradually became tense, confused, and distractible following the birth of a child. One day her husband came home and found her in a disorganized state. She talked continually of the whistle of the tea kettle and insisted the whistle had stopped because, quote, God turned it off, unquote. A psychiatrist made the diagnosis of a postpartum schizophrenic reaction and admitted the patient for treatment. After her recovery, analysis of the patient's abnormal response to whistling revealed that her mother had been in the habit of using a tin whistle to summon her children to meals. Following the birth of her child, the patient had felt a great need for help from her mother, but was unwilling to ask for it directly. Instead, she made great demands on her husband. When he was unable to fulfill her wishes, she began to pray to God for assistance. The patient began to imagine that she was the Virgin Mary, and in this setting, she interpreted the whistle of the tea kettle, which resembled that of her mother's whistle, as a sign from God. Another patient with hypersensitivity to whistles was a man who requested treatment because of jealousy, suspiciousness, and homosexual tendencies. One day he met a girl who he became convinced was a lesbian because he had heard her whistle. He stated that whistles were used as a secret code among homosexuals, particularly when they wanted to attract each other. Analysis of this notion led to the information that the patient's father, a clergyman, had regularly requested his son to listen to rehearsals of his Sunday sermons. The little boy, unable to comprehend the words, was spellbound by his father's oratory and would sit in a trance throughout the sermon, seemingly hypnotized by the sound of his father's voice. The undulating and pure tone quality of whistling always reminded him of his father's voice, and anyone who whistled exerted an irresistible fascination upon him. I have read the autobiography of Fred Lowry, known as the Blind Whistler. He doesn't say anything about using whistling as an echolocation technique. He learned in blind school a whole series of techniques for managing his life in as near a normal a way as possible, and bat-like behavior was not one of them. I enjoy Peter F. Ostwald's tangents, but he isn't always focused on human mouth whistling, and once again strays into musical instruments like pipes and flutes, and also mechanical whistles and a wide range of whistling sounds. Since the scholarly material on human musical whistling is pretty scant, we have to take what we can get. The stories of people having psychological issues with whistles is an interesting topic. There is a condition called misophonia, also known as selective sound sensitivity syndrome, which causes a pathological reaction to certain sounds, whistling included. This is in contention for a future episode, and I know from my own experience that my whistling has caused negative reactions in some people. Maybe it's just that I am an annoying person in general, and the whistling doesn't help things. Let's move on to the next section. The function of whistling in human relations. The function of whistling in human relations. Since whistling exists in many human and animal groups, it evidently plays a significant role in relations between individuals within these groups. In human society, whistles, like other sounds, help a person to orient himself in the world and permit him to maintain comfortable contacts with other persons at crucial moments. It is not only that the echo of his whistle provides the whistler with a sense of his whereabouts and assists him to avoid obstacles in his path. When he whistles, he hears his own sound directly, and this, like speaking, singing, humming, or any other form of sound making, gives him knowledge that he exists. It is like looking into a mirror or touching one's body. Such self-evaluative activities prove to the individual that he is alive, intact, and awake. It is the most immediate and reliable way to reassure himself. Reference Reusch and Keyes, 1956. Whistling also helps the individual to maintain his equilibrium during times of danger, boredom, fear, and loneliness, when he cannot share his feelings with others, or when such sharing would lead to trouble. During these times of stress or excitement, unpleasant emotions are contagious. The individual must control them, lest these emotions begin to reverberate between him and others, and like an echo, produce confusion. Whistling may strengthen his self-control. The whistler does not talk, yet he communicates. He keeps busy during the time of waiting, yet he is not overactive. This is probably why whistling, like foot tapping, smoking, chewing, and similar activities, occurs so often when people wait for a departure, prepare for a performance, watch an operation, and endure many other tense and potentially disagreeable moments. Whistling while we wait is simultaneously energy conserving and energy expending. Rather than fidget about and stir up others, the person quietly whistles. Yet the activity of whistling produces some fatigue, thereby soothing and calming the whistler. The whistler communicates too in a very specific way with his fellow man. With a whistle, he implies all sorts of inner moods, motives, and thoughts which keep the listener guessing. Like other nonverbal indicators of emotions, the meaning of the whistle cannot be definitely pinned down, so that the whistler is safe from criticism, discovery, and punishment. He can get away with expressing a whole range of feelings: hate, disdain, coolness, nonchalance, pity, and tenderness by whistling. And who will be the wiser? He can safely express many of the things for which he has not yet learned words, or for which no words exist, or whose verbalization is out of the question at the time. Reference Reusch and Keyes, 1956. Thus, in effect, whistling can bring people closer together. It is a form of communicative behavior which requires no training on the listener's part to be perceived and understood. While it does take practice, coordination, and effort to produce a whistle, whistling demands less training and skill than is necessary for speech, which requires facility with word symbols. Whistling is even a simpler form of communication than is music, because the listener must be receptive and tolerant in order to appreciate a musical message. Reference De Sirens, 1926. But whistling is not simply noise that results from random movement. Acoustically, whistling resembles a pure tone, has melodic form, and may even be rhythmical. Noises, on the other hand, are rough, irregular, and disorganized acoustic patterns. No planning or effort is needed to produce a noise, since one makes noise simply by walking, swallowing, or breathing. So I left that section uninterrupted by my overuse of sound effects. It was a nice series of thoughts on the meaning of whistling. I am going from now on to try and whistle more intentionally to feel more alive and important instead of just doing it unconsciously or to annoy other people. We can all be more mindful in everything we do. I will soon be reading world champion whistler Chris Ullman's book, Find Your Whistle, and maybe it will help me find the real me through whistling. And now the conclusion. Conclusion. From this information about whistling and human and animal behavior, whistling appears to be a special form of communication which lacks the complexity of speech and music. It is more complex than simple noisemaking. The experiences of the whistler concern mouth and body movements that may be pleasurable, as well as thoughts and emotions that range from excitement to depression. An analysis of the effects of whistling upon listeners shows that whistles arouse, annoy, alarm, and control others. Finally, whistling has its function in human relations. Whistling seems to help calm a person who is in danger and distress. It reinforces the whistler's belief that he is alive and aids in self-orientation. By whistling, an individual can establish contact with others. People whistle to communicate feelings which cannot be readily expressed in words. The end. So this article and the one before it, Whistling in Antiquity, are all of the primary source scholarly papers on the subject of whistling. I wanted to read them into the record for posterity. And now we can move on and have more fun with the topic of whistling. There is one short book called A Brief History of Whistling, and we will be discussing that in the future. It seems to be more about whistling in literature and poetry, and I want to read it twice before I try to condense its ideas into a single podcast episode. You have my book report to look forward to. And now, if you haven't had enough, I leave you with a story of the Pied Piper of Hamelin, presented by two great LibriVox readers. Enjoy, and I'll see you next time on the Whistling Podcast.
The Pied Piper of Hamelin.
A Child's Story by Robert Browning.
Hamelin Town's in Brunswick, by famous Hanover City.
The River Weser, deep and wide, washes its wall on the southern side.
A pleasanter spot you never spied, but, when begins my ditty, almost 500 years ago.
To see the townsfolk suffer so from vermin was a pity.
Rats. They fought the dogs and killed the cats, and bit the babies in the cradles.
And ate the cheeses out of the vats, and licked the soup from the cook's own ladles.
Split open the kegs of salted sprats, made nests inside men's Sunday hats.
And even spoiled the women's chats,
by drowning their speaking with shrieking and squeaking,
in 50 different sharps and flats.
At last the people in a body to the town hall came flocking.
"'Tis clear," cried they, "our mayor's a naughty, and as for our corporation, shocking.
To think we buy gowns lined with ermine, for dolts that can't or won't determine
what's best to rid us of our vermin?
You hope, because you're old and obese,
to find in the furry civic robe ease?
Rouse up, sirs.
Give your brains a racking
to find the remedy we're lacking.
Or, sure as fate, we'll send you packing. At this the mayor and corporation quaked with a mighty consternation. An hour they sat in council.
At length the mayor broke silence. For a guilder I'd my ermine gown sell. I wish I wore a mile hence.
It's easy to bid one rack one's brain. I'm sure my poor head aches again.
I've scratched it so, and all in vain.
Oh, for a trap. Just as he said this, what should hap? At the chamber door but a gentle tap.
Bless us, cried the mayor, what's that? With the corporation as he sat, looking little, though wondrous fat.
Nor brighter was his eye, nor moister, than a too long opened oyster. Save when at noon his paunch grew mutinous, for a plate of turtle, green and glutinous.
Only a scraping of shoes on the mat, anything like the sound of a rat, makes
my heart go pit-a-pat. Come in,
the
mayor cried, looking bigger. And in did come the strangest figure.
His queer long coat from heel to head was half of yellow and half of red.
And he himself was tall and thin, with sharp blue eyes, each like a pin.
With light loose hair, yet swarthy skin, no tuft on cheek nor beard on chin.
But lips where smiles went out and in. There was no guessing his kith and kin.
And nobody could enough admire the tall man in his quaint attire.
Quoth one, "It's as my great-grandsire, starting up at the trump of doom's tone, had walked his way from his painted tombstone."
He advanced to the council table,
and, "Please your honor," said he, "I'm able,
by means of a secret charm, to draw all creatures living beneath the sun,
that creep or swim or fly or run, after me so as you never saw. And I chiefly use my charm on creatures that do people harm,
the mole and toad and newt and viper,
and people call me the Pied Piper.
And here they noticed round his neck a scarf of red and yellow stripe,
to match with his coat of selfsame check, and at the scarf's end hung a pipe.
And his fingers they noticed were ever straying, as if impatient to be plain.
Upon this pipe, as low it dangled, over his vesture so old-fangled.
Yet, he said, "Poor piper as I am, in Tartary I freed the Cham, last June from his huge swarm of gnats.
I eased in Asia
the Nizam,
of a monstrous brood of vampire bats.
And as for what your brain bewilders, if I can rid your town of rats, will you give me 1,000 guilders?
One, 50,000, was the exclamation of the astonished mayor and corporation.
Into the street the pauper stepped, smiling first a little smile, as if he knew what magic slept in his quiet pipe the while.
Then, like a musical adept, to blow the pipe his lips he wrinkled, and green and blue his sharp eyes twinkled,
like a candle flame where salt is sprinkled.
And ere 3 shrill notes the pipe uttered, you heard as if an army muttered,
and the muttering grew to a grumbling,
and the grumbling grew to a mighty rumbling, and out of the houses the rats came tumbling. Great rats, small rats, lean rats, brawny rats, brown rats, black rats, gray rats, tawny rats, brave old trotters, gay young friskers, fathers, mothers, uncles, cousins, cocking tails and pricking whiskers, families by tens and dozens, brothers, sisters, husbands, wives, followed the piper for their lives.
From street to street he piped advancing, and step for step they followed dancing.
Until they came to the river Vaser, wherein all plunged and perished.
Save one, who, stout as Julius Caesar, swam across and lived to carry,
as he, the manuscript he cherished, to Ratland home his commentary.
Which was, "At the first shrill note of the pipe, I heard a sound of a scraping tripe,
and putting apples wondrous ripe into a cider press's gripe,
and a moving away of pickle tub boards,
and a leaving a jar of conserve cupboards,
and a drawing of the corks of train oil flask,
and a breaking of hoops of butter casks.
And it seems as if a voice, sweeter far than by harp or by psaltery,
is breathed,
called out,
Oh rats, rejoice! The world is grown to one vast dry psaltery,
so much on, crunch on, take your nunchon,
breakfast, supper, dinner, luncheon. And just as a bulky sugar punch on,
already staved, like a great sun shone,
glorious scarce an inch before me,
just as methought it said,
Come, bore me, I found the Vaser rolling o'er me.
You should have heard the Hamlin people
ringing the bells till they rocked the steeple.
Go, cried the mayor, and get long poles.
Poke out the nests and block up the holes.
Consult with carpenters and builders, and leave in our town not even a trace of the rats.
When suddenly, up the face of the piper perked in the marketplace with first,
if you please, my 1,000 guilders.
1,000 guilders? The mayor looked blue.
So did the corporation, too.
For council dinners made rare havoc, with claret, moselle, vin de grave, hock, and
half the money would replenish their cellar's biggest butt with rhenish,
to pay this sum to a wandering fellow with a gypsy coat of red and yellow.
Beside, quoth the mayor with a knowing wink, our business was done at the river's brink.
We saw with our eyes the vermin sink, and what's dead can't come to life, I think.
So, friend, we're not the folks to shrink from the duty of giving you something for drink and a matter of money to put in your poke.
But as for the guilders, what we spoke of them, as you very well know, was in joke.
Besides, our losses have made us thrifty. 1,000 guilders?
Come, take 50. The piper's face fell, and he cried,
No trifling. I can't wait. Beside, I've promised to visit by dinner time, Baghdad and accept the prime
of the head cook's pottage, all he's rich in, for having left in the caliph's kitchen
of a nest of scorpions no survivor.
With him I proved no bargain driver.
With you, don't think I'll bait a striver. And folks who put me in a passion may find me pipe after a different fashion. How?
Cried the mayor. Do you think I brook being worse treated than a cook?
Insulted by a lazy ribald, with idle pipe and vesture piebald.
You threaten us, fellow? Do your worst. Blow your pipe there till you burst.
Once more he stepped into the street, and to his lips again laid his long pipe, a smooth, straight cane.
And ere he blew three notes, such sweet, soft notes as yet musician's cunning never gave the enraptured air.
There was a rustling that seemed like a bustling of merry crowds jostling, pitching and hustling. Small feet were pattering, wooden shoes clattering, little hands clapping and little tongues chattering.
And like fowls in a farmyard when barley is scattering, out
came the children running, all the little boys and girls, with rosy cheeks and flaxen curls,
and sparkling eyes and teeth like pearls,
tripping and skipping, ran merrily after, the wonderful music was shouting and laughter.
The mayor was dumb, and the council stood as if they were changed into blocks of wood,
unable to move a step or cry to the children's merrily skipping by,
could only follow with the eye that joyous crowd at the piper's back.
But how the mayor was on the rack, and the wretched council bosoms beat, as a piper turned from the high street
to where the Weser rolled its waters right in the way of their sons and daughters.
However, he turned from south to west, and Koppelberg Hill his steps addressed,
and after him the children pressed. Great was the joy in every breast.
He never can cross that mighty top. He's forced to let the piping drop, and we shall see our children stop.
When lo, as they reached the mountainside, a wondrous portal opened wide,
as if a cavern were suddenly hollowed, and the piper advanced, and the children followed.
And when all were in, to the very last, the door in the mountainside shut fast.
Did I say all?
No.
One was lame, and could not dance the whole of the way. And in after years, if you would blame his sadness, he was used to say,
"It's dull in our town since my playmates left. I can't forget that I'm bereft of all the pleasant sights they see,
which the piper also promised me. For he led us, he said, to a joyous land,
joining the town and just at hand, where waters gushed and fruit trees grew,
and flowers put forth a fairer hue, and everything was strange and new.
The sparrows were brighter than peacocks here. And their dogs outran our fallow deer,
and honeybees had lost their stings, and horses were born with eagle's wings. And just as I became assured my lame foot would be speedily cured, the music stopped, and I stood still,
and found myself outside the hill, left alone against my will,
to go now limping as before, and never hear of that country more.
Alas for Hamelin.
There came into many a burgher's pate a text which says that heaven's gate
opes to the rich at as easy rate as the needle's eye takes a camel in.
The mayor sent east, west, north, and south to offer the piper by word of mouth,
wherever it was men's lot to find him,
silver and gold to his heart's content,
if he'd only return the way he went
and bring the children behind him.
But when they saw 'twas a lost endeavor, and piper and dancers were gone forever,
they made a decree that lawyers never should think their records dated duly.
If after the day of the month and year these words did not as well appear,
and so long after what happened here,
on the 22nd of July, 1376,
and the better in memory to fix the place of the children's last retreat,
they called it the Pied Piper Street, where any one playing on pipe or tabor
was sure for the future to lose his labor.
Nor suffered they hostelry or tavern
to shock with mirth a street so solemn,
but opposite the place of the cavern they wrote the story on a column.
And on the great church window painted the same, to make the world acquainted
how their children were stolen away, and there it stands to this very day.
And I must not omit to say
that in Transylvania there's a tribe
of alien people who ascribe
the outlandish ways and dress
of which their neighbors lay such stress
to their fathers and mothers having risen
out of some subterraneous prison
into which they were trepanned long time ago in a mighty band
out of Hamelin Town in Brunswick Land.
But how or why? They don't understand. So, Willie, let me and you be wipers of scores out with all men, especially pipers. And whether they pipe us free from rats or from mice,
if we've promised them aught,
let us keep our promise.
End of poem.
End of poem.